My name is Frederik Gildra. I work in ASML. That's a company close to Eindhoven. I will tell a little bit about what ASML is doing, because not everybody might know it. And I will tell a little bit about the process mining project we did last year. I will present some examples of findings that we found when doing process mining, and then on how we continue with process mining. So first of all, about ASML. ASML is in the semiconductor business, and well, in the semiconductor business, we are producing chips, and chips are everywhere, in your smartphone, in your tablet, in cars, in medical equipment, in all data centers running the internet. So chips are all around us, and actually quite a lot of chips, because I took some slides from the corporate material on how many chips are produced every year. In 2017, there were 290 billion. And if you calculate it back, that's about 40 for every person on the globe. So it's growing and growing, and you see the trend. Now it's 2019. Well, I don't know where it is now, but it's probably pretty high. To make chips or integrated circuits, you need a machine called a lithography tool. And that's the critical component in the whole chain to create chips. And that's exactly what ASML is building. You see a picture here of such a lithography machine. And, well, to say it very simple, it's copying from a recipe onto a wafer, a plate of silicium, and miniaturizing what it is doing. So most of the top chip makers in the world are using our equipment. To name some examples that you all know, Samsung, like your mobile phones, or your tablets, or maybe even your washing machines have chips in there. Another example is Intel, typically in your laptops and your personal computers. Another one is TSMC. You probably don't know TSMC, but if you have an Apple device, an iPhone, or any kind of Apple computer or an iPad, well, that's typically the chip in there is made by TSMC. So 2018, we sold around 11 billion, so we're getting quite a big company. And we're doing this with 23,000 people worldwide. The headquarters of ASML is in Veldhoven, just south of Eindhoven. And we have big offices also in the US, in San Diego, Wilton. And we have offices all around the globe where we serve our customers. So for example, Taiwan, Korea, Japan, and many other countries. One other interesting fact about ASML, it started, like many other things, as a spin-off from Philips. So it completely originated here in Veldhoven. Okay, now ASML is split in several sectors, and the sector that I'm working in is called development and engineering, and there with, well, I estimate around 6,000-7,000 engineers, we work on designing and engineering the machines that we built. And in this sector, we have a department called CSI. It does not stand for crime scene investigation, but for cross-sector structural improvements. And there we do projects to improve what we do in development and engineering. And that can be very broad. So we run kind of programs for operational excellence, well, that everybody can understand what it is about. But we also do things like a feedback loop program where we translate what we do in the field. We bring it back to the engineers that develop the machines so that they learn from what is happening in the field. And that can be on how the machine is working, how parts are breaking, why they are breaking, but it can also be on how customer support engineers are dealing with the machine. And the last years, we're doing more and more data science programs, and that is also where you can fit the process mining project into. So how did I now get to this project? Well, I was talking to some engineers in the department, and they were telling, well, we found a nice new technique, and it's called process mining, and we have a nice tool to show you some nice pictures. And they showed me pictures from a ticketing system that they analyzed. Well, that's quite interesting, but, well, I could not translate it immediately back to what I needed at the time for a project, so I kept it in my mind. And before I continue, one other thing that you need to understand is in our industry, it's very important that our machines are available all the time. So the more availability of our machines is, the higher production and the more our customers earn by doing it, by using them. And availability typically is addressed by improving or making our machines as good as possible, so preventing them from breaking. However, as with all machines, at some point they break. And the other thing that you can work on to increase your availability is the time from the moment that it breaks until the moment it is back up and running. And that is what we call the recovery time. Now, after I talked to my engineers a few weeks later, I went for a coffee and the machine in our floor was broken, so I went up another level. And there I ran into the VP for industrialization. And I worked with him quite a lot on improving the machines, but then he said to me, yeah, we also need to focus on this recovery instructions or recovery procedures. Why don't you come up with a project proposal? So his coffee was ready and he left. You know, those guys are quick. And I went back to my desk and I thought, well, maybe this is something interesting for process mining. So then I made a project proposal to analyze recovery sequences through process mining. So just to clarify the definitions a bit, what do I mean by recovery? That is typically the moment from where the machine is down, you swap the hardware, and then you need to start up the machine again. And what you need to do is you need to run all kinds of tests and calibrations, you need to do all kinds of manual actions, and then the machine is up and running again. What we typically did, and still also do, is we write down what we do. The people in the field are doing that, they write it down. And they send it back to Veldhoven and we analyze case by case what is happening. Not for all machines, but we compare typically the worst with the best cases and we try to learn what to do. So my proposal in this project is let's look at all those recoveries and let's analyze the whole population and let's do that based on machine logs. Typically we did based on handwritten observations, but the good thing is all our machines, they log all the tests that we execute with a start and a stop time, so that's quite good information. And all those machine logs we have available in Veldhoven. So we have a central database where all this information is coming back. So we can analyze these recoveries for all kinds of machines that we have out in the field. So that looked pretty promising. There were some challenges, however, because typically, when you look at a lot of the cases that you see with process mining, it is with a huge number of instances, 100,000, millions maybe, and we don't have that many instances. So we have a much lower number of recoveries. The number of machines we have in the field, I don't know exactly, but it's order of magnitude of thousands rather than millions, let's say. And, well, they break, but they don't break all that often also, of course. So the number of comparable recovery instances is limited. Another thing is, because the machines are used for production, you don't bring them down for maintenance tasks. So when you need to do some maintenance on the system when it's down, you save those tasks until the moment when it breaks, and then you quickly also do the maintenance tasks. And they kind of interfere with recovery sequences. So that makes it even harder to find. And then the last thing is, we do a lot of recoveries, but when do we do certain recoveries? If you ask somebody in ASML, they will typically say, well, you go into SAP and you look when a specific piece of hardware was swapped. And that's an interesting approach, but if you know a little bit about operations and being under customer pressure on fixing a machine, then you know that first you fix and then you write. And writing in our business is not always that easy because you work in a clean room. Our customers are pretty sensitive about information leakage, so you're not allowed always to bring your computer. You run shifts of 12 hours. When systems are broken, well, you might need to work a little bit longer. So it can be some days or weeks or some cases even months before you write down what you did. So you can imagine that the accuracy of that is not that great. So by using these machine logs, we have pretty interesting data. The only thing is, where do we have recoveries? Well, the good thing is, when you talk about recoveries, we have a tool that can exactly tell you which process to follow to build or to bring up the machine again. And you see on the picture on the left, you see an example of what comes out of the tool. Don't look at the details, it's very technical. I cannot execute it by far, but it's a lot of steps. And well, I named it the ABC recovery. Also, ASML is sensitive about what kind of information we share. So, but it doesn't matter for the story. I named it the ABC recovery. You need to do 140 process steps. If you drill down, you will find that there are 70 tests, specific tests that you need to execute in this recovery. And if you drill down even further, then you will find that there are 45 unique tests. So now finding out when a recovery happened, we built some kind of pattern matching tool that looks for this combination of 45 tests. And of course, tests are used in multiple kinds of recoveries, but you need a specific order of tests, and then you can identify a recovery. So we built that tool, and then we got some kind of insight in when specific recoveries occur. In this picture, you see the output of the tool, and the darker the color, the higher the probability that this specific recovery occurred. And then by hand, we investigated if it was really the case, yes or no. On the bottom, you see also that in three cases, we did not find any notification about the hardware swap in SAP, but still there was a recovery, so we took them into account. Well, then we have the data, and we can start process mining. So then we do the typical starting actions in process mining. You load the data into the tool. You make the kind of overview process with a spaghetti view. You start playing with the sliders to get more insight in what does the process look like. And then we remove the spider events, and then you get some kind of flow into the process. And this you can map back to this recovery instruction that I started with. And then we can start analyzing. Let me give some examples of findings that we had. In these 14 ABC recoveries, one of the things we analyzed was cleaning actions. And one of the things we found that 295 times in these 14 recoveries, there was a cleaning action. Such a cleaning action on a median takes about, 16 minutes, so that adds up to, on average, 5.5 hours of cleaning in a recovery. And this is not in the instructions, so this means this is more than we planned for. So this means an unhappy customer. So that's not good. We want happy customers. And it's not that they're not happy, but, well, they are unhappy, but they are unhappy because the whole rest of the production line depends on the system to be back in time. And if it's not back in time, you will have too much drifting of temperature, and the whole production line needs to be recalibrated. So it has a lot of impact. So if you're not accurate to the planning, it's quite a big problem. Another thing that we see here, we execute 295 times this cleaning test, but also in 67 cases it was needed. Of course, our customer support engineers don't just do something. They know from their experience that, well, certain cases might go wrong, and they could prevent it by doing a cleaning test. But they don't always know exactly where. So better safe than sorry, and they do it more often than they need to do it. So now we need to find a balance between doing it at the right moment and not doing it when it's not needed. So the learning here is we need to improve our sequences to better reflect what is really needed. And that is not so much a customer support activity, but more a development activity. So and then we also need to secure that in the end, when our sequences are better, we stick to the sequences and don't waste time on things we don't need to do. So this is one example. In the same recovery, we have another example. There's a specific type of initialization. Initialization you can compare to restarting your Windows computer. Everybody's used to that. Whenever you have a problem, you restart the machine. It gets better and better over time, but everybody's used to this. Well, it happens in our recoveries also. We found that although it's not in the instructions, it happens on average 8 times per recovery. And it takes median 1 hour. So this is 8 hours per recovery. So on top of the 5.5 hours we already had, it's yet another 8 hours that that we're spending more than we planned for. So again, this does not make our customer happy. The interesting thing about these kind of pictures is when you take them to the domain experts, you really trigger their interest because they say, yeah, well, we know we're initializing. We're doing things that are not in the instruction, but well, how much can it be? Well, by process mining, we show them what is happening and we can quantify it, and then they are really interested because, okay, this is where we can gain something, where we need to gain something to be able to meet our deadlines, our timelines. Another example, a totally different one. The last two examples were from our deep UV machines. Deep UV refers to deep ultraviolet. That's the kind of light we use for the workhorse machines now. And now we talk, this is about our newest generation of machines, and they use extreme ultraviolet light. And well, that's a rather complicated machine. To make light, we shoot with a pulse, with a very, very powerful laser on a droplet of tin that goes 50,000 times per second, and then you have to hit it, and then you create a plasma, and then you reflect it, and that goes into our scanner. So it's a rather complicated machine. And it's, well, the availability is less than it should be. And, well, for the machine, we have a state model implemented, and that state model that shows, if you see in the picture, when it goes from service to ready, that is kind of a recovery, just like we have for the other machines. And we have specific states defined, including a state which we call a manual mode, because we bring our machines to customers also when they're not completely ready. So we do co-development with customers, let's say, and in some cases you need to manually override the automatic actions. Ideally, you want to do it automatic, because automatic is predictable. That typically meets the timelines, and you have the better behavior. But sometimes you need the manual mode. And I was talking to the system engineer availability, so that's the guy who's technically responsible for the availability of the systems. He's a very busy guy because he doesn't make his numbers. And I told him, well, you're using the people in the field are using manual mode quite a lot. Well, he said again, he said, yeah, well, that's true, we use manual mode, but yeah, how much can it be? So we came with the process mining picture, and we showed him from which state we use manual mode, how often we use manual mode, and how much time we consume because of doing all these kind of things. And then he was really shocked. It really triggered his interest, and then we started meeting on a weekly basis to deep dive on this recovery sequences. So we showed him the process mining picture. He was looking at it and asking, why do they do this? Why do they do that? I couldn't answer. It was his domain to answer. But it triggered his interest, and he found that, yeah, this is really an area where we should improve and where we can gain some time. So when we deep dived, we kind of had two main conclusions on this. This manual mode that was used, well, where he thought it was fairly low numbers, it was used in almost all recoveries and on average for 20 times, so that was pretty high. And the other thing is, for each of the state transitions, we have a budget where the state transition should be completed in that amount of time. And if you see the picture on the bottom, you see that in quite some cases, that's not the case, so we need to improve there to be able to meet our specs. So, what did we learn? Well, first of all, The discovery feature of process mining is really powerful. It really helps us to find out what is really happening in the field. We can design very nice sequences and instructions, and we see that in practice what is done is totally different. And we need to understand why, because it's different for a reason, and that will really help us to improve our recovery instructions. It's good to trigger interest of people. It's also good that it can quantify things, because first you talk about feelings, and now you talk about facts. Another lesson we learned is that you really need to combine domain expertise with the data preparation and process mining skills. Our machines are complex to the level that in our department, well, we know something about the machines, and some people know quite a lot, but you really need the domain experts on the table, because you can analyze for quite a while something, and then you go to an expert and says, yeah, that I knew because, and then he explains with all kinds of physics why it's like that. So you need them on the table as soon as possible. The high variation in processes, that makes it quite hard to compare processes. That's also, that's what we saw from the beginning, and that remained difficult. And the data preparation, that took a lot of time and effort. So how does it continue? We translated findings into improvement areas. One thing is to find where you need to improve. The other thing is, of course, how to improve. That is not always easy, but at least we know in our recovery instructions, we need to improve the instructions as they are, and we know the areas where we can improve to make them quicker. These instructions are mostly carried out by our customer support department. And now, as an example, we analyzed some of those sequences, but we trained our customer support department, and we gave them the tools to be able to do this for all the recovery instructions they are doing. So whenever they run into issues there, where they're not meeting the timelines, they can analyze themselves. Then we added it also to our CSI toolbox. So we do process improvement projects for other kinds of things where we can use it. For example, in lean projects, it's a very nice to use tool. And last but not least, we're also promoting further use of process mining in ASML across other parts of ASML. I have two colleagues from the finance department who are also using it. They're also present here, so they can maybe in the breaks tell you what they are going to do with it. So we're using it all across the company nowadays. Okay, that's my story. Questions?
Question, you can raise your hand. I will start off with the first question, but we will get the microphone to you so you can ask Freek your questions in a moment. Now, I will start with the first question, and what I'm wondering is, you mentioned that there's these very long sequences, right? And that's something you have per machine or for test, you have these very long cases. So they are much longer than you would see in other type of processes for these type of processes here. Yeah. And at the same time, you have a lot of variation in the processes themselves. So that means that if you look at the data set, you will have just unique variants, and there will be not any kind of grouping in the variants. So what I was wondering, because you mentioned, is that you did some aggregation. So you, for example, looked at unique codes only, and you took out the spider activities, and you took certain steps. By doing those things, did you ever get to a level where the variants were useful, or they were never really getting to this level?
If you have the simpler swaps, so with maybe up to 25 steps, then you get some kind of variance. But for most swaps, we studied the longer ones, then it's very difficult, and you kind of have unique variants all the time.
Yeah. Right. So you really are working through the process map there.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Who has a question for Freek? Okay, we will get a microphone to you. 1 second.
Hi. When you said data preparation takes a lot of time, if you say like the whole thing up until the analysis where you decided to make improvements was 100% of the time, what percent of that would be the data preparation, would you say?
It's a cyclic thing. Yeah? So we worked, we had our customers, let's say every week. If you need to put it in time, maybe 60% of the time is in data preparation, I would say. But you need to spend it on the whole project. So you do cycle after cycle, and the earlier you have contact with your customers, the better. And probably after some meetings, you need to go back and adjust your data set and look at it again. Yeah.
Okay. Another question?
Yeah, so thanks for your talk. It's great to see that in ASML now process mining is being applied in different parts. What Anna did not mention is that I think 12 years ago she did a conformance checking study on the testing processes of these wafer steppers. The question that I have is that you have lots of variants, and because the traces are long, everything is deviating in some way from what you expected. Yeah. But it seems that you have a pretty good idea of what you want to happen. So did you try to apply conformance checking techniques to see where the deviations are? Because that may make life easier.
We clearly identified this performance checking as an area to investigate, but there was not so much support in the tooling we used at the moment. So we had the discussion on the features we would like, but we had two tools that we used, and we could not really make the conformance checking to work in this case.
If you do that, you can also quantify where in which areas the biggest deviations are, and that may help in diagnosis.
So that might be a very interesting next step, but we need some tool support in that also.
Other questions for Freek?
I have a question regarding your organizational decision to bring process mining competence to several service employees, and how come you didn't choose to build up a centralized process mining competence center?
Well, I think that's a bit related to the company culture in ASML, and so we are a very big company with a lot of smart and how do you call it in English? In Dutch it's eigenwijs. People that want to do it their own way. So, that's very hard to centrally control it, and I don't think it's needed either. We have a kind of a process mining competence network, so we have a competence defined, and somebody's kind of leading the competence. We are meeting each other over different sectors. So that's I had a graduation student working in the finance domain. Now the finance domain is picking it up by themselves. And that we see also happening in the logistics domain. So there is a kind of process mining community, but there is not a single department doing this.
Hello. Talking to a pillow. That's cool. So were you challenged by activity order? In other words, different technicians doing the same job, but doing them in a different order?
Sorry, can you ask?
So many times a process can be done in a whole variety of different orders. This can go first, or this can go first, this can go second, and so on and so forth. And different people have developed over time their best practices approach, and therefore, when you look at process mining, the activity order isn't helpful because it's all over the map.
Well, typically in recoveries, we have a predefined order because that's what the experts determined as the best way to restart the system. And what you typically get, if it's not complete, that people in the field will add their own knowledge. But they are maybe a bit on the safe side. And by being on the safe side, you lose so much time. So they definitely add knowledge, but in the end, it should all boil down to one sequence that should be most feasible to recover the system in the quickest possible way.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, one more question here.
Yeah, good story. How do you apply it in the control phase? Because you want to make sure that those improvements are being put in place. And how do you have then following checks, and that people, it's part of the organizational structure in tier meetings to verify whether the performance meets expectations?
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah. So the question, how do you embed it in the organization, is kind of what you ask, on that the improvements are really put in place. Yeah, that's a difficult one in HTML. So we would need to do some kind of conformance checking in the end. That's ideally what we would like to do. We are not there yet, so we for now used it very much as an analysis tool. Let's say we did a one-time snapshot analysis of where we are, and to check if things are as they should be, we need to follow it up with making yet another snapshot. So we don't do continuous monitoring of this at the moment. Yeah, but in principle, the customer support department is equipped with the means to do it, so when needed, they could do that, but I don't think they do it at the moment.
Okay.
Have you tried to predict what is the impact of applying now the changes from the process mining? I mean, you have done the process mining, I guess this lead to some change. Did you try to predict what will, how the future will look like and how the recovery will improve by that?
Well, we did not really predict. We could identify quite some actions where we question if they were needed or not. So we kind of identified improvement potential, but it is very much up to the experts if you can really realize that potential. So yeah, so no real prediction yet. No.
I have the question, but it depends on the first question. How long have you been conducting process mining? That's what you're presenting. How long have been conducted?
So you're asking how long this whole process has been running, this project has been running. Yeah, the project has been running for about 9 months. Okay. And we analyzed the different tracks. You didn't see them all here. So, yeah.
And
so,
when was the last time that you present the result to your stakeholders?
That was somewhere the end of last year. So I'm working on a different project now, but somewhere the end of last year. Yeah.
Okay. And afterwards, what was the action taken by your stakeholders? Because you presented the results, what happened? Did they have took time to understand why did it happen and they did something and then have you monitor what was the action afterwards done?
I didn't monitor the action, but I can say that with this EUV source, with this system engineer availability that is monitoring the availability of the system and looks into these recovery sequences. And there's the department we hired, I don't know how it's called, an analyst or maybe, but let's say a process miner to do this job and to do it on a more structural basis to continuously analyze if we're meeting our specs. So this is implemented into our organizational structure. Yeah.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, let's thank Fred again. Okay. Thanks. Okay.